Good evening and a very warm welcome to you all this evening to Evensong, and welcome to those who are joining us on Zoom as well. We begin our service this evening with our opening hymn number 5. Dearly beloved, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying with me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The choir sing Psalm 40.
Out of the mire and The Old Testament reading is written in the first book of Kings, chapter 22, beginning at the first verse. For 3 years, Aram and Israel continued without war. But in the third year, King Jehoshaphat of Judah came down to the king of Israel. The king of Israel said to his servants, "Do you know that Ramoth-Gilead belongs to us, yet we are doing nothing to take it out of the hand of the king of Aram?" He said to Jehoshaphat, "Will you go with me to battle at Ramoth-Gilead?" Jehoshaphat replied to the king of Israel, "I am as you are. My people are your people, my horses are your horses." But Jehoshaphat also said to the king of Israel, "Inquire first for the word of the Lord." Then the king of Israel gathered the prophets together, about 400 of them, and said to them, "Shall I go to battle against Ramoth-Gilead, or shall I refrain?" They said, "Go up, for the Lord will give it into the hand of the king." But Jehoshaphat said, "Is there no other prophet of the Lord here of whom we may inquire?" The king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, "There is still one other by whom we may inquire of the Lord, Micaiah, son of Imlah. But I hate him, for he never prophesies anything favorable about me, but only disaster." Jehoshaphat said, "Let the king not say such a thing." Then the king of Israel summoned an officer and said, "Bring quickly Micaiah, son of Imlah." Now the king of Israel and King Jehoshaphat of Judah were sitting on their thrones, arrayed in their robes, at the threshing floor at the entrance of the gate of Samaria. And all the prophets were prophesying before them. Zedekiah, son of Chenaanah, made for himself horns of iron and said, "Thus says the Lord, with these you shall gore the Arameans until they are destroyed." All the prophets were prophesying the same and saying, "Go up to Ramoth-Gilead and triumph. The Lord will give it into the hand of the king." The messenger who had gone to summon Micaiah said to him, "Look, the words of the prophets with one accord are favorable to the king. Let your word be like the word of one of them and speak favorably." But Micaiah said, "As the Lord lives, whatever the Lord says to me, that I will speak." When he had come to the king said to him, "Micaiah, shall we go to Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall we refrain?" He answered him, "Go up and triumph. The Lord will give it into the hand of the king." But the king said to him, "How many times must I make you swear to tell me nothing but the truth in the name of the Lord?" Then Micaiah said, "I saw all Israel scattered on the mountains, like sheep that have no shepherd. And the Lord said, 'These have no master. Let each one go home in peace.'" The king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, "Did I not tell you that he would not prophesy anything favorable about me, but only disaster?" Then Micaiah said, "Therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, with all the host of heaven standing beside him to the right and to the left of him. And the Lord said, 'Who will entice Ahab so that he may go up and fall at Ramoth-Gilead?' Then one said one thing and another said another, until a spirit came forward and stood before the Lord, saying, 'I will entice him.' 'How?' the Lord asked him. He replied, 'I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouth of all his prophets.' Then the Lord said, 'You are to entice him, and you shall succeed. Go out and do it.' So you see, the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouth of all these your prophets. The Lord has decreed disaster for you." Then Zedekiah, son of Chenaanah, came up to Micaiah, slapped him on the cheek, and said, "Which way did the spirit of the Lord pass from me to speak to you?" Micaiah replied, "You will find out on that day when you go in to hide in an inner chamber." The king of Israel then ordered, "Take Micaiah and return him to Amon, the governor of the city, and Joash, the king's son, and say, 'Thus says the king, put this fellow in prison and feed him on reduced rations of bread and water until I come in peace.'" Micaiah said, "If you return in peace, the Lord has not spoken by me." And he said, "Hear you peoples, all of you." Here ends the Old Testament reading. The New Testament reading is written in Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 15, beginning at the fourth verse. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you, for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. And again Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who rises to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here ends the New Testament reading.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Now and forever.
Amen.
us to proceed. Give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour.
Amen.
Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Sheet and do take it home with you. Just to highlight that there are still some Christmas cards that need delivering around the parish so that the people will know what services we have over Christmas. So if you can take a great bunch of those, that would be really helpful. Today, of course, is our toy service Sunday. So if you have brought any toys with you, you're very welcome to bring them up and to place them in front of the altar at the end of the service. And a reminder, if you don't already know, that next Sunday evening will be our carol service. And now the choir will sing the anthem, Rejoice in the Lord, attributed to John Radford.
Rejoice in the Lord.
I am of a certain personality type that prefers to perceive and notice an overview, a sort of bird's eye view, rather than taking notice of small details. It doesn't mean I don't notice the small details, but to me, the overview is the most important thing. So as I reflect and ponder the many mysteries of life such that the Christian spiritual faith portrays and proclaims, I'm always asking myself, so what? What's the point? And what is this or that trying to tell us about the life that we live? And because I like to think, and I hope it is true, that as each day passes and we move from year to year, I am continually developing and growing up and maturing in every respect, I come round regularly to ask the same questions again and again, but seeing different answers. So at the beginning of this new Christian year, I ask myself, what is Advent really saying to us? Of course, we love the traditional Advent music and the prayers, the Advent carols, and as we approach Christmas, the lights. I suspect that many of you have Advent lights in your windows. In Sweden, a very dark place most of the day at this time of the year, everyone hangs paper stars in their windows that are lit from within. It's a beautiful sight to see. But why, I ask myself. So often we enjoy these things and get so absorbed in them without asking why. It's like these delights absorb all of our attention that there's little chance to stand back and be present enough to enjoying these things more consciously and knowingly. So when I read this evening's reading from Paul's uplifting passage in his letter to the Romans, there was one word that stood out for me as being at the heart of what we are about in Advent, and indeed in the whole Christian faith. For, says Paul, whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Hope. Hope encapsulates that which would give our lives and our existence meaning and purpose, would make them worthwhile, and would satisfy us, and ultimately would give us a peace deep down that is possible, but which I know is rare. Paul continues his desire that we might have hope with this sentence. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Jesus Christ, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Advent, when so much of the themes are about light coming into the darkness, about us becoming aware of our sleeping in unconsciousness, about the coming or dawning of that light and consciousness in our personal lives and in the life of the world. A dawning which Christianity, of course, focuses upon in the coming of Christ. Advent is about our hope of that dawning. Hope means that it hasn't quite arrived, but we can sense it and feel it growing within us. It is the hope that we believe is given to us in Jesus Christ. And the one thing it seems to me that is a source of real hope for all of us in our individual lives, as well as the life of the world, is, or would be, harmony. Who hasn't felt that wonderful sense of deep joy when things work together in harmony? Perhaps our choir could speak of the peculiar sense of joy and hope that they must feel when joining together in singing in harmony. Perhaps that's why we feel drawn to listen to music, which in its harmonious beauty reminds us or resonates deeply within us and gives us hope. That harmony is what Paul recognizes as the source and desire of hope, that he prays God might grant us as we live in harmony with one another. Hope comes from the scriptures and from our lives as we work together, not caught up in dissensions, disagreements, or arguments, but giving glory to God with one voice, like a choir, with harmony, which is a diverse and rich form of unison or unity. Hope is the foundation of our faith, of the whole Christian year, the fulfillment of which God desires for all of us, for each of us in our personal lives, for each of us in our own sphere of lives that we're moving and in the world in which we live, and yet which is so evidently lacking too often. Everything at the beginning of this new cycle of our faith points to this hope, that we might all, and I mean all, because it will take every one of us to be included, that we might work towards living in harmony, accepting one another as we are, rather than as we would like each other to be. We all know that it's a really tall order, but one that we all want and hope for. The coming of light, hope, and peace into our world. And so this Advent, as Paul said, may the hope, the God of hope, fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we watch, we wait, we look, we long for you. Dispel the clouds and darkness and awaken us to your glory, that we may walk in your light and know your hope. Lord, you are ever among us. Open our eyes to your presence, that your church may be true to its mission, that each congregation may proclaim your goodness, that all of us may show forth your glory. Come, Lord Jesus, that there may be hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
To the nations that are looking for freedom, to the peoples that are longing for liberty, to the individuals striving for justice, to all who are seeking to improve the world, to all who are seeking to improve themselves, come, Lord Jesus, and give hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
To our homes as we prepare for your coming, to our loved ones as they reveal to us your love, to our work that it may show forth your presence into our leisure and into our pleasures. Come, Lord Jesus, bring your hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
To all who long for release, to all who cry in pain, to the sick in body, in mind, and in spirit, to those who can no longer cope, to all who are oppressed and in darkness, to all who watch and wait and weep for you. Come, Lord Jesus, give your hope. And we continue particularly to pray for Jane Johnson, Darren Gooch, Ian Kenyon, Hanny van der Plas, Jason Easton, and Trevor Stewart. That we may know that life is eternal, that loved ones departed are in your keeping, that we may rejoice in hope, that we may come to your glory. Come, Lord Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We continue to pray for those who have died recently, Christopher Surfleet, Anne Foucault, Peter Ainsley, Wendy Gordon, and Mandy Richardson. We pray also for those whose year's mind falls at this time, praying particularly for Eric Harvey Smallwood, Rosemary Evelyn Millard, Joshua David Caswell, Albert Edward Harris, and Kay Coward. May your eternal light and hope surround them into all eternity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We join together in the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, be with us all evermore. Amen. Christ, the Sun of Righteousness, shine upon you, scatter the darkness from before your path, and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.